Alleluia, Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. Alleluia. As we celebrate Pentecost, we focus on the event as it's recorded in Acts chapter 2. And the day of Pentecost in Greek is literally the 50th day. Today is the day celebrated in the Old Testament as Shavuot, which means literally weeks. This feast, the Feast of Weeks, was prominently a feast for Israel. It was commanded by God to celebrate 50 days after the Passover. On this mandatory festival day, what did they celebrate? The giving of the law to Moses at Mount Sinai. It was the glorious day of remembrance of the awesome and glorious sight of God speaking with Moses face to face, giving to his children the holy and perfect law of God. The law of God is good and wise and sets his will before our eyes, shows us the way of righteousness, and dooms to death when we transgress. Could there be any more of a perfect text for us to reflect upon this week than that of Pentecost? What a great day our Lord used. The day of celebrating the law became the day in which the gospel was given, preached in different languages by the very men that God had ordained and sent to give his gifts. The disciples have this miraculous thing happen to them, and they go out into the world and they receive the same mixed reactions from the crowd gathered all over the world. Some are amazed at what the leaders of the church have to say, and others think they're drunk. So it is today. How are we to react to the many things happening in our world? How are we to react to the many things happening in our church? What is the message that we hear? How do we teach and act for God today? Are we living in a time, we are living in a time where we have clear violations of the Word of God being celebrated. We even have those who are being persecuted, those who stand up for the Word of God. If we look at the two realms or the two hands of God, we fall into a false dichotomy of God and the world. Many of us have a tendency to look at the church and God as good, while the world is the same as Satan, and that is bad. But this is not completely true, though, is it? The world and its kingdoms still belong to God. First article gifts and all the things that God still does in the world. God is the ruler of the heavens and the earth. That means that God works for us and through us in two different ways. On the right hand is the church. Here God is concerned with justification. Here he is concerned with how I stand before him. Here on his right hand, God is concerned with my relationship with him. Through his right hand, God gives us justification. He declares us not guilty through word, specifically through the word made flesh, given continually to us through his servants of the word. Peace given to you through words that you hear, and words joined with water, with bread and wine, words that you can see, touch, taste, and smell. On the left hand is God's work through creation. Here he is concerned with our relationship with each other. The goal here is not justification, rather the goal here is justice. The work is done through the sword by the servants of the state. They also work for peace, and they get peace little by little. It is through the left hand that we can talk about the works of vocation. How do you live your lives in the best service towards your neighbor? What does God require of you as a parent, or a child, or a spouse, or a manager, or a worker, a farmer, a government official, a teacher, a truck driver, a nurse, etc.? What does God expect of you towards your neighbor? What is your responsibility towards the care of His creation? So we constantly live in these two realms, my relationship before God and my relationship with my neighbor. And keep in mind, there is always a distinction of sinner and sin. The church gets accused of being bigots, but we have never condemned the people. The mantra is love the sinner, hate the sin. There is a tension. Scripture tells us that our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil. It is in this tension that we get the question regarding the intersection of church and state. There are many ways that the church has tried to address this question. In the Lutheran Church, we have constantly concluded that the church and the state are in paradox. God works in both. Both have their proper places and functions. Both are important, but there is a tension that exists. Give to God that which is God's, and give to Caesar that which is Caesar's. And in this tension, at times, through our culture, the right hand speaks louder, and sometimes the left hand speaks louder. But we must always remember that both realms belong to God, and God does work through both. But how are we to live as the church, as the body of Christ, when we see things in the left hand going completely out of God's word? It is easy to focus on the many negative things that are in our world, and even in our own bodies and in our own lives, from our failures to fill our vocations, from our failures to live as the perfect spouse or parent, to our failures at work. Our vocations are hard. St. Paul reminds us that all fall short of the glory of God. But you, gathered here today, from all walks of life, today is your Pentecost. You are in a wonderful position. Even among the many negatives happening in our world, you are in a wonderful place. God has baptized you for this moment. The church does the church best when it is the church. What does this mean? The church gathers around Christ. We feed on His sacrament. It is here that we see, that we realize our position, our place before God and before one another. There is not one of us here who is better than anybody else. We're all sinners. We all fail. We all are forgiven. We all are subservient to God, and then in turn to each other. I'm not here to serve myself. God has served me, and now I have the wonderful task of serving you. And so we gather under God's word and under God's sacraments. We come bearing the filth and the stench of our failures and our sinful bodies. We drudge up these steps. We kneel before God, and we lay our burdens at His feet. As we drudge, we most rightly first walk right by the baptismal font. Has anyone ever noticed that? We walk by the font, the very place where we were washed in the blood of the Lamb, the very place where we were born with water and the Spirit, with water and the Word, the very place where we received the sign of the cross, both upon our foreheads and upon our hearts, to mark us as ones who have been redeemed by Christ crucified. We then fall right here at His feet, and we cry aloud, "Lord, forgive me." And what do we hear? We then hear, we receive, "Take, eat the body of Christ. Take and drink the blood of Christ." These very gifts of God given for you. We gather together, and then we stand together. And as we do, our burdens and our cares are taken by God, and in their place we take the burdens of others. As I stand before God, I am forgiven and given peace fully and rightly. I then have the glorious task of looking out for you. I don't have to look out for myself because you look out for me. The church does the church best when it is the church. We pray, we are fed, we walk together. We are in a wonderful position to witness to the world, but where do we start? First, we must ask if we have it right. Do we understand the whole issue of marriage and sexuality and abortion and time management and parenting and creation? Do we understand our living for each other? Do our kids? That is why we have Sunday school and vacation Bible school and ACT meetings and Bible studies. What does God's Word say about these things? See, we are in a wonderful position to pray and to study and to teach. You who are justified through Christ, your Pentecost is here today. You have peace in the full. That is peace that we all want to know, is it not? So we gather, just like the apostles did, for fear of the outside world. They gather behind locked doors, and Jesus appears in their midst, and he says to them, "Peace be to you." Then the next week, Thomas was there. He wasn't there the first time. He missed the first week, and so he came the second week, and Jesus again appears to them and says, "Peace to you, Thomas. Touch my hands and my side. It's me." So we gather today. Jesus comes in a very special way, and what does he say? "Peace to you." Be calm. Be still. And know that I am God. My ways are not your ways. Peace. You have it. Peace in your marriage. You have peace. I am God, and I am more powerful than anything that causes you trouble. Peace. Peace with your children. Peace at work. Peace in any and every relationship you can now have with each other because you have peace. Let us pray. Come, Holy Fire, comfort true. Grant us the will your work to do. And in your service to abide, let trials turn us not aside. Lord, by your power prepare each heart, and to our weakness strength impart, that bravely here we may contend, through life and death, to you, our Lord, ascend. Alleluia. Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. Alleluia.